It's time for us to have a conversation on the health segment this morning. Now, just before we give you that on the health segment, of course, Dr. Wusu has joined us on the show this morning. And just to remind you that MyGHP is back with a bang. Now, MyGHP is saying that they have revamped a lot of things on the app. And now you have so many different new things that you will find, new services that are on the app. So push notifications have come in-app reporting, new services like data bundle purchasing, and box office subscriptions as well. GHQR payment options and security features like Face ID as well as fingerprint logins are also available. Of course, MyGHP is Ghana's biggest online payment solution. So you go to Apple Store or Google Play Store, and you can download the app there, and you're good to go. All right, MyGHP, buy, sell, connect. Now, on the health segment this morning, we want to have a very important conversation. Typhoid fever, what is it? And this season in particular, as we're getting into rains and all that, is that going to have any impact on the instances of typhoid fever within our society, yes or no? And all the ins and outs of that. Let's welcome Dr. Kelvin Owusu this morning. Good morning.
Good morning, David.
How are you doing?
Very well, and you?
I'm very good. Awesome. Thank you. So let's get right into the conversation. Okay. Typhoid fever. Mm-hmm. You know, in Ghana, as soon as you start to get temperature and all of that, mm-hmm. we usually assume, oh, it's malaria, or in vernacular, then you'll say, menya fever.
Yeah.
You know, and yeah. Menya fever just basically generalizes. You know,
the whole show,
you know. But of course, diseases are very specific, mm-hmm. you know. And so if you don't target the right causative agent, then you're going to be struggling with it for a while.
True.
Talk to us about typhoid fever.
Well, typhoid fever is actually quite common, like you rightly said. And the challenge with typhoid is that you mentioned that these are specific, but typhoid is not too specific in our setting because there are so many diseases that look alike. You know, I mean, in fact, the commonest cause of fever is usually a viral infection, so cold, now COVID, etc. Then malaria is also there, but depending on where you are, malaria is usually number one anyway.
Okay.
Then typhoid is also in the mix, you know. But if you are quite observant, you realize that the fever of malaria, it sort of follows a wave-like pattern. It goes up, it comes down, it goes up, it comes down.
Yes.
Now, the fever for typhoid is constantly going up.
Ooh.
So it goes up, stays up.
Okay.
You know, pretty much like that. So that's one of the ways to distinguish between the two.
Okay.
You know, I mean, and most of us have had malaria before, so we know, you understand what I'm talking about, that the fever comes on, then it sort of dips, and, you know, you feel fine some point, then, you know, you are not too well again, you know, so it's kind of like that.
Mm. Okay, so let's sort of break it down. Let's go to the malaria, look at the cyclical nature of the fever there. So my experience has been that typically, you break into a sweat in the night.
Exactly.
And then in the morning, you almost feel fine.
Exactly.
You know, as if there's nothing wrong.
Yeah.
Then as you're going towards the evening, you start to feel unwell again.
Yeah.
You know, and the fever starts to build again. Why is that the case there? And the typhoid case, it's not the same.
Well, different. That's where the differences in the causative agents come in. You know, malaria is a protozoan disease.
Okay.
Whereas typhoid is a bacterial disease.
Okay.
You know, so they are two very different organisms, even though we find them in the same sort of area. And they are precipitated by the same conditions. I mean, the rains come, you know, the floods happen, then there's a lot of malaria alongside a lot of typhoid as well, because typhoid is spread by fecal oral transmission. When we say fecal oral, it means that it's spread when you make contact with an infected person's stool. You know, then you have typhoid. But one may ask, I mean, I won't look at stool and go and touch it.
No.
But we are exposed to this in so many ways.
Okay.
You know, because unfortunately, a lot of our people do not have access to a closed or water closet, you know, a hygienic way of disposing of their human excreta. And so we find human excreta in all sorts of places that we don't want them to be. Mm. And so inadvertently, it contaminates our water source.
Okay.
Now, a lot of us drink water from the tap. Mm. There could be a puncture in the piping system. So when the rains come in, there could be human excreta nearby, which is washed into the piping system. Mm. And then you use it to wash your fruits. You know, we don't usually cook our fruits.
Yeah.
So now, you, in your mind, you have actually washed your fruits quite well. Mm. But unfortunately, the water you used to wash the fruits was contaminated. Or in this era of hand washing because of COVID, hand washing is actually one of the ways to prevent typhoid.
Okay.
But only if you use soap.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, how do you know the water you're using is not contaminated by some human excreta that was washed into the system at some point?
Okay.
You know, and so that's how easy it is to catch typhoid. Mm. You know. But the thing, and the interesting thing is that typhoid, the bacteria that cause, that's a Salmonella typhi,
okay.
And there's another one, Salmonella paratyphi. So the two of them, even though they cause different diseases, they are similar. So Salmonella typhi will cause typhoid fever.
Okay.
Salmonella paratyphi will cause paratyphoid fever. But I mean, hey, it's all the same pretty much. They have similar symptoms. So
okay.
It's only when it comes to academic aspect that we try to separate them.
Okay.
So now you've gone through the process of washing your fruit, washing your vegetables. You're trying to eat healthy, but you end up actually getting yourself infected. And I was saying that typhoid is a human infection. There's no intermediate host.
Okay.
In other words, if we are able to prevent contact or contamination from human excreta, we can actually deal with typhoid once and for all.
Wow.
In fact, there are jurisdictions where they hardly have any typhoid fever that you get in certain jurisdictions is imported.
I see.
That's how far advanced they are. And so we know that if we're able to put some of these measures, barrier, we can actually deal with typhoid fever. Unfortunately, we are not there yet, and so we still deal with typhoid fever quite often.
Mm. Mm-hmm. But what does this say about us? You know, any places where we've not been able to deal with typhoid? I mean, from what you're describing, it's not a good description of who we are
at all. And again, one other aspect. Let me just make it a bit more complicated. Not everyone who is infected with the bacteria, typhoid causing bacteria, will exhibit the symptoms. There are asymptomatic carriers around, and that makes it even more difficult because you don't. If everybody had the symptom, then everybody would go and get treated. But here's the case: this person is shedding the bacteria, but doesn't show any symptoms.
Okay.
You know,
now how come?
Yes, because that's the pathophysiology of the bacteria.
Okay.
It's not everybody.
So some people will not show.
Some people will not show symptoms, and there's a peaceful coexistence between them and the bacteria. So all they do is infect everybody else, and they are fine. You know, in fact, there's a if you go back in history, there's a case called a lady called Typhoid, or nicknamed Typhoid Mary.
Oh.
Yes, it happened in America where she was an asymptomatic carrier. And she literally infected a lot of people in the USA because everywhere she went, she didn't know she was sick, and she was just shedding the bacteria and everybody was catching it. And that's how that's what led to food handlers being screened for typhoid.
Okay.
Because if you had to wait for symptoms, what if the person never develops the symptoms?
Mm.
So one of the key category of people that we need to screen for typhoid are food handlers. So any person who handles food, whether in manufacturing, whether in restaurants, whether by the roadside, should actually be screened for typhoid.
Mm.
Because once that person is shedding the bacteria, everybody who buys food or anybody who consumes that food is at risk of being infected.
Yeah.
It's very, very important.
I think the Ghana Health Service even has a regulation for food vendors.
They do.
That you have to have screening and show that you're cleared for typhoid.
So as a buyer, you should actually ask your vendor to show you their certificate.
Wow.
Yes, because so
if somebody has a store and they're selling jollof rice,
they should have a certificate.
And they don't have a certificate from Ghana Health Service that they are clean of typhoid. They should not be
shut down. It's actually not Ghana Health Service. It's from the local assemblies that actually enforce that. So everybody who sells food should actually have registered with the local assembly, and as part of the registration process, you're supposed to get screened for typhoid, among other things.
Okay.
And this certificate is renewed every year.
Mm.
So it is your right to actually ask the food vendor to show you their certification.
I see.
You know, but unfortunately, many of us
can't be bothered with it.
You know, and
we'll pray over the food.
it's typhoid is a big deal, and it's fatal.
Mm.
Now,
oh, it is?
Oh, yes, it is. If you don't treat, if typhoid doesn't get treated, it leads to a lot of severe complications. One of the most common complications is intestinal perforation.
I see.
So we have a condition called typhoid perforation, and it's very common in the emergency room. People come in, abdominal pain, and serious abdominal pain. They are leaking abdominal content into the peritoneum.
Yeah.
You know, that's very, very serious. Wow. And that's because they had typhoid, which was poorly treated.
Mm.
And so I mentioned, and that's why I started by trying to compare with typhoid to malaria. It's quite difficult to distinguish between the two. Not everybody is observant enough to know that my fever has been constant or my fever is going up and down. You know, so it's a bit difficult to distinguish between the two.
Mm.
And then the treatment for malaria usually has no role in the treatment of typhoid because protozoan treatment
is completely different from bacteria.
Exactly. So you cannot take malaria medication and expect it to treat the typhoid that you have.
Mm.
You know, and so often times people are treated for malaria when in natural sense they may have had a typhoid.
Yeah.
Then the typhoid is missed, they come in a couple of days later with a typhoid perforation, which can be fatal if not attended to quickly. You know, of course, this is not also to say that once you are diagnosed of having malaria, you should also treat for typhoid. It doesn't work like that. But the point is, you should be aware that, especially if you buy food from outside and you know that your area, your surrounding is not clean, you should know that typhoid is also a risk. And so when you are reporting to your medical practitioner, you should give him all the information that is requested, so that then they would request the appropriate test to make sure that you have either malaria or typhoid, or if both of them are coexisting, then they both get treated.
Yeah.
Because if treated properly, it can actually it can be cured.
Okay.
Because oftentimes you hear people say that my typhoid is back. You know, it's not typhoid can become chronic, but the number of people that get chronic typhoid is not that many.
Okay.
In fact, if you look at the data, only about less than 5% will get chronic typhoid infection.
Okay.
And so we hear too many times that my typhoid is back. It's not like a hypertension.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like a diabetes. It's a treatable condition, incurable condition. So once you are diagnosed of having a typhoid, you need to go through a full treatment, a full antibiotic course, and then get over that treatment and go for review. And every time I come here, I keep mentioning that one of the biggest challenges we have as a people is we don't go for review.
Yeah.
We don't go back to give the doctor a report of what has happened to us. Most people are more likely to go to a different health practitioner than to go back to the same one who actually prescribed the medication.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so follow up is always a big challenge. And that is why the treatment and follow-up of typhoid is also an issue in our setting.
All right. So I have another question for you. But those of you who are watching, you want to ask Dr. Kevin Owusu any questions regarding typhoid fever, kindly use the WhatsApp line 055-0585-8532. The hashtag is, of course, Breakfast Daily. We want to hear from you. Now, in terms of the mode of transmission, we're talking about, you said fecal-oral, right? Now, in terms of the practice, you mentioned about washing of fruits and with water that's contaminated. Are there any other ways? So somebody is watching very carefully the way they wash their food in terms of, I bought the fruit.
Yeah.
I'm washing my fruit well. Okay, is that enough? Or, of course, you mentioned food vendors as well.
Yeah.
Are there any other ways that we need to watch out, you know, to protect ourselves from?
I mean, I think the easiest one to observe is when you are buying food from food vendors. If that person, or the first of all, is the place kept neat enough? Because if their surrounding is not neat, obviously whatever they are using to prepare the food would not be neat as well. So if the surrounding is not neat, avoid. If the person selling or handling the food is obviously unwell, you need to avoid. You know, I mean, you cannot expect that you are buying food from an unwell person and you will not have repercussions.
Yeah.
So avoid that as well. So that's the easiest thing. And so they say that if you can cook your own food, it's always best.
Mm.
If you can't cook your own food, make sure that the person you are buying the food from or the person who is preparing the food for you is obeying the rules of hygiene, because that's the most important thing. Unfortunately, it's a bit difficult to keep up or to keep track of the water coming from your tap. It's very difficult to check whether it's being contaminated or not. You know, because you can't see the contagions. You know, you can only assume that everything is fine. But some people go a step further by actually washing their fruits and everything with soap. you know, their fruit, they wash it with soap.
Yeah.
You know, and they make and a lot of water to rinse off to the soap afterwards. That's a bit extreme, but hey, you can't be too careful.
Yeah, well,
when it comes to vegetables, then you can use your vinegar and salt and other things, soak it in the salt, because the salt will sort of dehydrate the bacteria and then kill them. Mm. You know, so all these measures can be done to help minimize the risk of getting yourself infected. Okay. But ultimately, the institutions that are charged with making sure that hygiene is maintained across board need to be up and doing, because the economic cost of typhoid is high and it impacts everybody. If one food vendor is infected with typhoid, let's say it's an asymptomatic carrier,
yeah,
it can infect hundreds of people, especially in a busy area. Let's take a Makola, where at lunchtime everybody is buying from this food vendor or that food vendor. Thousands of people can be infected from one person, and each person who is infected is going to carry that infection to their house, and in the house there are children, and the children are going to carry it to school. And in the school there are other children who are going to carry the infection to their houses.
Wow.
And so just one source of infection can spread across the whole country pretty much. And so it's a big deal, and it's just a big deal. I mean, I can't overemphasize that.
Okay, so I think we have one. Okay, so some messages come through. This is a very good topic. Thanks for your education. This is coming from Lydia and so on. Elekem in Tabora says, I was once diagnosed of both malaria and typhoid. I never understood why it was so. Okay, thank you for those messages. But you've explained that it's within the same environment,
yes,
you know, that they both thrive. So quick question. The symptoms of typhoid, how does one know beyond the fever that this could be typhoid?
So typhoid symptoms are, like I said, similar to malaria. So you have the fever, the headache, the loss of appetite, the weakness and all that.
Yeah.
And in addition, you have some abdominal symptoms as well. So you may have, and this is the thing, you might have diarrhea or constipation.
Okay.
So it's not just diarrhea or it's not just constipation. You can have either one or the other.
Okay.
You know, and then abdominal pain and cramping is also possible when you have typhoid. So apart from the malaria symptoms, there's also the associated abdominal symptoms as well with typhoid.
Mm. I see. I understand sometimes there's some effects in your mouth as well. Is that possible?
You can in the mouth specifically, not necessarily, but you could have the breakout of herpes on your lips, which is usually a feature of immunosuppression. And then once your immune system is challenged, if you have herpes, it will break out, you know, and so that is there. And then you can also have some skin rashes with typhoid. You can also have some presentation of skin rashes, which is some flat skin rashes, you know, on the abdomen, you know, and other parts of the body. So but you see, these ones are usually missed because it's flat. It's not raised that you can actually pass hand over it and feel it. So except you do a thorough examination and you notice all of these things. But basically, if you have any of these symptoms, don't self-medicate, because the challenge we also have is that a lot of people spend so much time at home self-medicating. You see, yes, we've said that typhoid is treated by antibiotics, but there are different antibiotics for different purposes. The fact that it's a bacterial infection doesn't mean that any antibiotic can just work for it. You need, even when you come to the hospital and you are being treated, they won't just give you anything. Sometimes they'll run a test. They will take your sample to the lab, isolate the typhoid that you have, and then run tests on which antibiotic will actually work perfectly for this particular one. Okay. You know, so if you sit in the house and just take any medication, you are wasting your own time and money. And that is how people then report to hospital with perforation. They end up dying. So it's a big deal.
Okay. Miriam in Tessano says, I've been feeling nauseous lately. Is this a possible cause?
Well, nausea is a very, very broad topic. But yes, typhoid can cause nausea. It can cause vomiting as well. And so does malaria, so does even COVID, so does a lot of things. Yeah. And so don't just, so does pregnancy.
Yeah.
I mean, by
so
the
don't
name.
Assume.
So don't assume. Just go and check.
Yeah, it's important. No, I think it's typhoid is one of those illnesses that sort of gets us, because there are so many similar symptoms to other, you know, things as well. So, Dr. Owusu, where can people find you?
Well, I'm active on social media at Kelvin Owusu MD. So you can ask, I can address any question that anybody has.
As simple as that, Dr. Kelvin Owusu MD.